stick to a couple of points that I do want to make today, but I did want to start out by talking about the older adult and HIV education in terms of prevention. When you were speaking a little bit earlier, Charles, it reminded me of my education team last year got invited out to a 55 plus complex, and we thought, oh, this is interesting, we've not done this before in terms of HIV prevention, sure, we'll go out. And my two younger educators, younger than me, I'll say, went out and were completely unprepared for what unfolded, which was that they'd go and talk so that folks could speak to their grandkids about it, right? The first thing somebody said was, well, there's more swapping in going on in this complex than there is in a flea market. What? You know, and it was really, really very, very rich conversations. They actually wanted to know about sexual activity themselves, and nobody wanted to talk to them about it. That their healthcare providers didn't want to talk to them about it. They felt embarrassed to bring it up. And there was questions as, you know, one woman had asked, well, this guy I really want to get busy with, but you know, he's wearing pens and I want to be able to talk about cleanliness, and how do I do that? So great team that I had, they jumped right in and started having some conversations, but it really talks about, again, we need to acknowledge that sexuality runs the spectrum and it doesn't, you know, and so yay, I can't wait until I'm in that swap meet. not my partner won't like that, but so I do want to talk about the fact that in 2009, we launched a client survey to talk to our clients about a review of our health promotion activities at that time to say, what is it that people are looking for in meeting? And the results of that really led us towards self-management tools. That's what people were looking for. And that they were wanting to focus already in 2009 on aging. We knew that was going to be an emerging issue. And thank goodness for CIHRRC, because that's where we reached out to. And so for folks like Dale, who's been along the ride with us over the last number of years, we can't thank enough of the advice and support that we've had. The result of that then meant for us is that we looked at the revision of those programs and it really focused on social isolation, around mental health support, and around HIV comorbidities. And I am not an OT. Our OT is on that loop, so I'm going to still say, yay, OT. And that really, what that was a natural fit, really, as we started to talk about a revision of programs, we knew that one of the pieces that we were missing was occupational therapy, and that would blend beautifully into our interdisciplinary team. So we launched a pilot and got some funding and did a pilot program in 2010. And over the series of about 18 months, we knew that we were onto something, that embedding that into our already rich team was going to lead to better outcomes. And as much as all of those stars align, and it rarely does, as funding, we were able to actually secure permanent funding and now have a permanent occupational therapist as a part of that, of our team. And this is where I fly by the seat of my pants. I say I'm not trying to change one single page here. I stood here and talked to you. I've used this puzzle a lot to talk about an interdisciplinary team at Nine Circles. And over the last week, I've come to hate it. So really, I've talked about how rich our team is, and it really is. We do have an amazing team. We have social work, we have mental health therapists, we have occupational therapists, we have pharmacists, we have dietitian, we have, of course, our physicians and our nurses. And then in that care team, we also really look at who the client, their family, their friends, their neighbors, who's the support of that individual, who's within that circle of care. And the reason why I say that I've started to not like this is that this looks really clean. It's quite pretty, right? Everybody's roles fit in perfectly together, and it's a wonderful puzzle. And as I was sitting at my table, I'm jotting, this is where my thoughts are going. This is much messier. but this is what it realistically is. And for us at Nine Circles, the challenge has been not how to figure out how a social worker fits perfectly into a beautiful puzzle with a mental health therapist and a doctor and a nurse, because they don't fit perfectly in together. There's overlap. And so really, you know, we'll have the client, we have their nursing, we have their doctor, we have their mental health therapist, we have their occupational therapist. And this is incredible breadth of folks that are working with them. And whose role is what? Where's the scope of practice within those individuals? A lot of the work over the last couple of years with our occupational therapists has been to figure out so much. So now we have all these great people. Who are they? What are they each going to focus on? And some of that is absolutely client-driven at the time, but there's overlap within all of these, right? And depending on the clinic that you're in, an occupational therapist may take on a much more of a role of a social worker, and the social worker that of a mental health therapist. Again, depending on who it is that you have within your team. For us, that richness posed a different challenge. We suddenly had an enormous amount of expertise at the table. And how are we going to manage without bumbling over each other, without falling over each other, without having to ask the client the same questions over and over again? And think, well, I just saw an occupational therapist yesterday, and this is what she was dealing with. Why are you talking to me about this? And so it's taken some time, and we're certainly, I'm going to say that we're at the end of the road because it's an evolving, to determine what are your scope of practice and what is it that we were particularly looking for out of the occupational therapist. And I think bringing that in led us to a lot of those questions. And so for us, because we had the mental health therapist, because we had the social worker, we look at the role of the OT as these are some of the primary focuses that the individual does. And so pain management is an extremely important area of her work. And so whether that may be running workshops in groups around pain management, speaking to folks about how to have a conversation with their physician around pain, about how to chart and document their pain, and as well as physical activity, so that certainly has played out its role into that. So we've been bringing in, we were talking earlier about the successes and challenges of some physical activity programming. A number of years ago, we tried a walking group, and the other thing you may learn is I have a very difficult time not swearing, so I'm going to try not to do that right now. But we were given a number of very strong languages from folks about walking. And they're like, well, I walked 3 miles to get here. I don't have access to a bus, and I don't have access to a vehicle. And so now you want me to walk. Like, are you crazy? So we've integrated some different approaches. Employment has become the other area of expertise, and returning to the workforce, and whether that be employment or volunteering, but the occupational therapist role has really focused on that. And the other around activities of daily living and of cognition. And so those, and I spoke earlier in terms of one of my questions around one of the challenges that we've had around some of those standardized assessments that just don't meet the needs of the population of our folks here in Winnipeg. And I have given my warning, also the gift of gab, and you usually go over, but I won't.